primary reason why we do Gaussian elimination, of course, is to solve systems of linear equations. But along the way, we also get pivots and ranks. So REF, the row echelon form, will give you the pivots right away, because after the row reduction, after Gaussian elimination, you have the REF where you see the pivots right away. And the number of pivots will be the rank. So the rank also is given by Gaussian elimination. Although we are doing only row reduction, meaning we are only doing elementary row operations, you could think of doing elementary column operations for some other purpose, for the purpose of finding pivots and ranks, for instance. But that will not give you the solutions to the same set of equations, because when you do column operations, then the solutions will change. But there is a theorem that states that if you find the number of pivots using row operations or by using column operations, you get the same number. The row rank is the same as the column rank. But the column reduction can also be thought of as taking the matrix, taking its transpose, and then doing the row operations. And we saw that the rank is the minimum of the number of rows and the number of columns. Number of columns is the number of variables. Number of rows is the number of equations. So the rank of A cannot be greater than the number of unknowns. It cannot be greater than the number of equations either. If the rank is the same as the number of equations, then you have a unique solution. Now, in order to get the determinant, you can do determinants by using the output of Gaussian elimination, which is the REF. Because the row operations, the third row operation, I should say, has a property that it does not change the determinant. That is, the third row operation is taking a multiple of a row and adding it to another row. That does not change the determinant. But if you swap two rows, then you will introduce a negative sign. REF will give you an upper triangular matrix. For a square matrix, if the upper triangular matrix is a full rank one, meaning it got pivots in every column and every row, then the determinant is the product of the diagonal elements. And if it is not full rank, at least one row will not have a pivot on the diagonal. Pivot will be to the right of the diagonal, which means that diagonal element is going to be zero. Then the product will be zero. The determinant is going to be zero. It's a square matrix and I have a zero here. So that immediately tells me that the determinant is zero, because the determinant is the product of this guy, this guy, this guy and this guy. And if there is a zero along the diagonal, then the determinant is zero. But it can be seen in another way also, saying that the rank of this matrix, the number of pivots, 1, 2, 3. So the rank is 3 and the maximum possible rank is 4. So it's rank deficient. So it's determinant is zero by the fact that it doesn't have enough rank also. If you want to find the determinant, the best way of doing it, not the easiest for human beings, but the most efficient way of doing it using a computer, is to actually do Gaussian elimination. After that, it's just a multiplication. So if you want to compute the determinant of the 4x4 matrix like this, it is a horrible computation. If you want to do it by hand, it's a horrible computation. The Laplace expansion is not easy to do. If you ask a computer to do it, if you ask SageMath to do it, it doesn't do it that way, because that is inefficient. What it does is actually it does REF first and it computes the product of the diagonal elements. It could be plus or minus, because if the computation of REF required the program to do a row exchange, then it's actually negative. But it'll keep track of the number of times it did the row exchange also. And that is the most efficient way of doing it. Now, what we have after Gaussian elimination is an upper triangular matrix, but we still don't have the solution. So we have to find the solution now. So that is the next step. That is done by something called back substitution. So the primary objective was to solve a system of linear equations. We got the REF, which is an upper triangular matrix. So what we will do is take the last non-zero row in the upper triangular matrix, and that basically has only one element on the coefficient side and only one element or one value on the constant side. That solves one variable and use that in the previous row. You get the second last variable and then you keep going up. In order to do the row elimination, in order to get to the REF, you go down the matrix once. After that, you go up the matrix using back substitution to get all the variables back. So I'll show you an example, then it'll become clearer. So you use the last non-zero row to get the solution of the last variable, and then it'll keep going up. You iterate until you run out of variables. So let's look at an example. We get the augmented matrix and you subtract the first row from the second to get the REF. There's only one operation. You get the REF already. So two pivots and the rank is 2. That means full rank. That means a unique solution. Now use the last row. The last row basically reads the second variable times minus 2 is equal to minus 4. Minus 2y is equal to minus 4. That means y equal to 4. So you use that to get y and then you just subtract it in the previous row. Okay, back substitute in the row number 1. So x plus y is equal to 5. That means x plus 2 equal to y, because y is 2. And then you get 3. We said that in some cases we might have an infinity of solutions and you have to write it down somehow. That would be the complete solution. That will happen when the number of variables is more than the number of equations. I have 3 variables here, x, y, and z, but I have only 2 equations. First thing I do is to create the augmented matrix x plus y plus z equal to 6, 1, 1, 1, and 6, 2, 2, 1, and 9. So then I find the REF twice the first row, subtract from the second row. So minus 2 plus 1, so minus 1 there. Okay, minus 12 plus 9, so minus 3 there. So I get my row echelon form. My pivots are here, two pivots and three unknowns. So I'm going to get an infinity of solutions. No inconsistency, no 0 equal to non-zero. This column is for no pivot. I'm going to keep the variable corresponding to the pivotless column to be free. I'll say that that variable can take any value. Then I'll try to solve for the rest. Let's take the last row. So that reads minus z equal to minus 3. That means z equal to 3. Back substitute in the previous row. And I'm going to keep y equal to 0. I get x plus y plus 3 equal to 6. That means x plus y equal to 3. And then I'll take y to be 0. If I take y to be 0, what I get as x is actually 3. Then I have z equal to 3, x equal to 3. So I get this and this. Another way of looking at it is to say that y can take any value. Since it's a free variable, any value in R is okay for that. So let me take a general value t, and then x is equal to 3 minus t, because x plus y equal to 3. So I can write the complete set of solution like that. X, y, and z. X is equal to 3 minus t, y equal to 2 t, and z equal to 3. And then I can decompose it into two components. One reads 3, 0, 3, and the second one reads t times minus 1 times 1 and times 0. Now, if you look at it, the first one here is a solution to the two equations when y equal to 0. Set y equal to 0, x is 3, z is 3, so x plus z is 6, that is fine. 2x is 2 times 3, that is 6, this is 0, and z is 3, so 6 plus 3, 9. So it's a solution to the set of equations where the free variable is set to 0. That is my first vector there. The second vector is something that can be scaled, and any scale version of that vector can be added to this vector. And that is still a solution, which is the freedom that you get by the fact that you have a free variable, infinity of solutions. So that is what the complete solution is. What I wrote is I have these two equations and I have that solution. And the solution had one constant vector and another vector times any number, a scale version of another vector. So I'm going to call the constant vector my particular solution and the other vector my special solution, which can be scaled by any scalar t. So the solution is particular solution plus scale version of the special solution. So xp is a particular solution, and that is a solution, as we saw, when you set the free variable y to be 0. Why is y the free variable? Because that corresponds to the pivotless column in the REF. Now xs is one special solution, and if you want to have something that is unique, take the unit vector along that direction. That might be called the special solution if you want. So complete solution is also called the general solution. So I had one vector, that is xp, 3, 0, 3. I'm not going to draw this to scale or anything. I'm just going to say that that is some vector, particular solution, xp. Now I have special solution, xs, some other vector pointing in some other direction. And when I add a scale version of that to this, the scale version will all fall on that line. And when I add a constant to it, I am moving that guy to the tip of this one. So I have a line through the tip of this one, and any vector from the origin to this line will be a solution. So I have a line of solutions. So in general, you have a particular solution plus one scale version of one special solution, another scale version of another special solution, a linear combination of special solution. Suppose you had only two of them, that would mean a plane. Two vectors and their linear combinations will form a plane going through the origin, and you're taking the particular solution and moving this plane to the tip of that particular solution, infinity of solutions. All the vectors whose tip falls on the plane will be a solution to the system. So a particular solution plus the linear combination of the special solutions, that is the general solution. Special solution is actually the solution to the equation Ax equal to 0. So let me show this to you. My special solution is minus 1, 1, 0. And if I take this guy and put this to 0, and take this guy, I put this to 0, and look at x equal to minus 1, y equal to 1, z equal to 0. That is indeed true. And I take this guy, minus 2, 2, 0. That also is satisfied. So special solutions are solutions to Ax equal to 0. And this one is called homogeneous system of equations because all the terms on the left and right are all of the same order. Everything has order 1 in the variable. So x to the power 1, y to the power 1, z to the power 1. So that is a linear homogeneous equation. Square plus xy plus y square is homogeneous in order 2. X plus y is homogeneous in order 1. This system is a homogeneous system of equations. And so the special solutions are also called homogeneous solutions.